Okay, I want to do a little video on this shotgun here. This is my Husqvarna Model 20. This is sort of the more rough example. I got another one that's quite a lot better shape, but this would be sort of the, you know, drag around the woods one. But you can see somebody's varnished or shellacked over the lock and stuff like that. So, and it's got quite a lot of finish wear. Like, it would have had like case hardening color to the action here, and the barrels would have been blue. You can kind of see here a bit of the bluing where it wasn't worn away. But it's anyway, it's still quite functional. It's a bit looser than the other one, but it's still, like, the opening lever, you can open it quite easily. The other one's a lot tighter than this one, but I forget the date of this one. It was like 1929 or something like that it was made. But let's go over a little bit of the details of it. Oh, you know, I'll take the barrels off and show you some of the markings. There's not a whole lot on these, not like the Belgian or the Spanish guns. They got like gazillion different proof marks and different things like that. Like, it doesn't tell you like the bore diameters or the chokes or any of that kind of stuff, as far as I can figure. So, but this one, I think it's like double full, or I guess it'd be considered like extra full. Like, all these older guns are excessively choked just because of the ammunition of the time period. But if you're loading black powder and the old fiber wads and stuff, it isn't really an issue as far as I can like, it won't like destroy the game bird or whatever. So I just use black or Pyrodex in these anyway. I think the interwib says the ones that are made like after 1945 are considered, you can use them with smokeless safely, but a lot of people use the ones that predate that with smokeless, but just sort of, you know, black powder pressure loads or mild loads or whatever. But anyway, I don't, you know, if it was your only gun and didn't have black powder or whatever, but if you got smokeless guns, then what's the, I don't see much point in worrying about that kind of stuff. Just make black powder ammo for these ones, and I'll shoot all the smokeless ammo in the, you know, the Russian double or the more modern ones. But anyway, that's for up for the, you know, do what you want, I guess. So let's look at some of the things about it. So let's see, it's got back action locks, which are nice. They make kind of a nice slim wrist here. I think these are walnut. I believe the ones later were I think had beechwood stocks. It's got the straight grip. Some of the newer ones had a pistol grip. Got steel butt plate on it, as you can see. Sling swivel, which is nice. A lot of shotguns from this part of the world, they don't put swivels on shotguns, and I don't know why, because usually you're carrying the thing more than you're hunting with it. So, and if you're carrying the big armload of game birds that you harvested, then, you know, you can sling the gun. Which, so you got two triggers. That's the under lever, or it's like LeFranco, or however you pronounce that guy's name. I think he was a Frenchman that designed this type of action. So, and you see it on a lot of older Belgian shotguns, and I guess French for that matter. The Swedes kept making them like way past pretty much everybody else had kind of given up on it, because most, you know, normal shotguns, they have a wooden hand grip, and then the open has like an opening lever here. And there is models of Husqvarnas like the 51 and the, I guess there's some other, like a 52 and a 48, or there's a whole bunch of different ones, but they're basically identical, but they have the four wood and then the opening lever. But pretty much they got like the back action locks, and everything else is basically the same. So, but this sort of like as you shoot these, if you shoot them quite a lot, the barrels get quite hot, and there's not a whole lot to hold on to here. So that's sort of one downside that I've noticed using these. But so you get, you know, hammers and everything. You got rebounding or spring-loaded firing pins. Like these were basically a working man's gun. They're quite plain. There's not any fancy stuff going on. Like they even got a plain rib. There's a few markings on here. It says Husqvarna Vapen Fabriques AB. It says that on both barrels, but I don't think it actually says anything else on here. There's quite a not very many markings on these things. You got your forward swivel that's screwed on. And then you got your front bead. And fairly thick barrels. I think the chokes are identical in both barrels on this one, I think. But and then, as I said, I showed you it. Your opening lever to push it this way to open it. And these are 2.5 inch, so you basically gotta make up your own shells with like a roll crimper or something like that. So, or you know, some people get them chambers cut out a little bit, but I didn't find it necessary to mess with the thing. So, as you can see, somebody painted it a little bit. They put shellac or varnish or something onto it, but whatever. Suppose I could refinish it, but it's not a big deal anyway. Let's see if I can get it to so that you can open it like that. It's just got extractors that push the, you can see some of the down there inside, you can kind of see what the case hardening would have looked like. So you open it this way and then you push this other lever here the other way. Let's see if I can get this to work. And you can take the barrel off. There. So you can see how that works. See some of the hardening there, and it has 20, which is model 20. So, and then you got, there's not a whole lot on these. Let's see. So you got model 20 there again. You got the serial number. Husqvarna, proof mark. Yeah, what's that? That's just rust spot, I guess. And you got your extractor there. But yeah, so there's not a whole lot on them. Like they don't give you bore dimensions or anything. So here. You got this here, this is the lock that holds it into the action, or the forward one. And then back here is the part that locks it shut. It's basically like that thing there that pivots with the under lever. It's basically sort of like a T-shaped thing, head on the top of it. And then that goes into this thing here, so it's sort of double lock, sort of. Well, I guess be like one, but anyway, so that's how it works. So, but yeah, you know, it's good. Finish is a bit rough, but she's quite usable. So, a little bit of surface rust and stuff, but there's no real active rust or anything going on, so just keep it oiled. So, and there's a little groove there where that little thing that sticks up there, It's like a shark fin. It pushes on the extractor back when you open it. So, but these were like super inexpensive for what they are when they were available. I think there's a few around. I think the price has kind of skyrocketed in the last few years, but I think people didn't really know what they were, or they were turned off by the 2.5-inch thing because you couldn't just buy ammo at Walmart or whatever and had to make your own ammo. But for people that know what they are, they're quite a good gun. That's pretty much all the Swedish made guns were good, like the old underlevers, and then the 52s that, or the 51s. I think there was a 52 as well. There's a staggering amount of models that they make. And then the hammerless ones that he made, they're all fairly decent. So, like the 310 model, and then there was a whole bunch of them. So, and they were fairly inexpensive, and a lot of the newer ones actually use 2 3/4. So, but they're made out of good material. They're put together well. Like you can look at the fit and finish on these things. You know, like the metal, the wood is really good on them, and they stood the test of time. Like a lot of these are old, and they're still going. But anyway, I kind of enjoy these old things. Anyways, that's just a little closer look on the thing. So hopefully you enjoyed that, and we will talk to you later.